Hey everybody, DJ Lou here, and up next we're going to talk about microphones and frequencies. Now, I see these questions pop up so often on the forums, you know, should I be changing my microphone? Is my current microphone good enough? I'm on such and such frequency, is this safe? What brand should I be using? You know, let's kind of try to clear the air a little bit. Let's debunk some myths that are out there, you know, get some clear facts straight. And hopefully you'll end up making a proper choice when you decide to purchase a new microphone. So first, let's start talking about microphones and the tiers that they kind of live on. I would dare say that there's basically three tiers that most mobile DJs would ultimately consider. You got your first tier, you know, you're talking around the $100 per microphone. Some of them have, you know, four channels, you know, you'll see those around $350, $500. You know, branding wise, you're usually GTTs, AKGs, and some others. And I've actually owned AKG single microphone. I've owned a GTD quad 1U rack mount microphone, or microphone set that I've owned back in the days. These are, I would say that, yes, you can get away with using them, but ultimately the quality does kind of fail you depending on your use case. Now, me as a wedding DJ, I kind of got by on these. You know, I needed a microphone quick, so I bought my first, you know, single channel, the AKG, but it was just fair. It would be the best term for that. As I kind of stepped up, I needed more microphones, so I gravitated towards a GTD quad microphone set, bought a bunch of handhelds, a few lav packs, and over the ear that was really massively sized in comparison to some of the other microphones that are out there. And again, I kind of got by with this. You know, I went a full entire season on it. Most of the time, I'd say about 80% of the time, it worked. I was usually in a very clear line of sight. There wasn't a lot of conflicts I had to worry about. But it was that 20% that I ran into that just became a real headache for me. You know, there was times where the antennas were switching. The GTT did have antenna diversity, but when it switched, you would actually hear the switch off happen. And it was just, it ultimately just, it failed me enough where I didn't want these failures to represent my brand or anything. And it wasn't anything superly major, but I was so critical about the quality of service that I was offering that I just couldn't consider these lower end microphones anymore. Now, if you're a karaoke DJ, you know, you especially worry about wear and tear, you know, people destroying the microphones, these microphones will work. You know, there's nothing inherently wrong with them. They're relatively inexpensive. They're decent performers. They can take some abuse. You know, if they do get abused, to replace them, they're not that much. So if you're doing something like karaoke where you're not worried about, you know, high quality vocal replication or anything like that, you know, by all means, you know, aim towards this end because you don't want to waste your money on higher quality microphones. That being said, if you're a wedding DJ like me, you know, now it's kind of time to step up the game a little bit to get at least into the second tier. And these second tiers are usually occupied by Sennheiser, by Shure, and by Audio-Technica. Typically, they're starting around the $550 to $650 range for a combination of a receiver and a handheld, or a receiver and a lav pack. These have been just stalwarts both within you know, the mobile DJ, the wedding community, to stage and acting and concerts and all these. You know, these are very well proven units to really, you know, consider and to use. Are they cheap? They're not cheap, but, you know, given that, you know, for me, you know, I'm doing 70-80% of my weddings, I'm doing the ceremonies. So I need that high quality. I don't want to be, you know, fretting that, you know, something's going to happen to these microphones and, you know, I'm going to have poor quality. I'm also passing off my audio to the videographers when my clients, you know, decide to go with them. So I want to make sure that the highest quality that I can offer is, you know, presented to those vendors. And then there's a third, or even a higher tier, that some mobile DJs do consider. Shure occupies this space with the ULXD. They have a quad unit and a single rack mount, so it saves a lot of space, has the antenna combiner already built in compared to some of the others in kind of that second tier space. But you're spending around, you know, $10,000 for a single set of four with your mics and your lavs. I would love to do this. It's a little hard for me to justify the more than double in cost, especially since in that second tier range, I'm already getting, you know, very high quality solution out of it. I haven't had any frequency interference or anything like that. But some people just have a zero compromise policy, and I completely appreciate that. They want to reduce their rack space, and this definitely can. But overall, if you stick in the tier two to tier three range and you have critical audio, this is where you should be. If you go tier one, and I know plenty of DJs that do, and they'll swear by it, and it's not a bad solution. I never want to say there's an actual real bad solution out there. It's just you're introducing more risk into what you're providing. Whether that's quality of range, quality of the voice replication, quality of having those fallouts, if you're having some type of interference, being able to more adeptly switch frequencies or find those occupy frequencies so you're not worried about the interference. These are things all to consider. Once you get into that tier two and tier three space, you get frequency scanning and stuff. If you have, let's say, multiple mics and you bought, say, the Sennheiser, the G4 lineup, now you can actually connect those up and be able to scan all your mics with just the one scan, as opposed to my G3 mics, which you have to do those individually. It's a little bit of a pain, but it's just something you have to do and you kind of build into your setup process and whatnot. But overall, again, you stick to that tier two, stick to the tier three. If you're less concerned about it, you can get away with the tier one side of the equation, and there's your microphones. All right, now let's talk about frequencies, and let's get 600 megahertz, just out in front. For many people, they're seeing that their 600 megahertz spectrum is being eaten up by T-Mobile's because T-Mobile has acquired that spectrum, and they're lighting up more and more areas. So, when they saw that the deadline was mid-2020 for the flip over, they weren't quite paying attention that as T-Mobile decides to light up an area, well, guess what? You're now competing against T-Mobile for that area, and most likely you're going to just not have a good time trying to work around that. So for those that are using 600 megahertz and still aren't having problems, there's a very good chance you're going to have problems sooner than later. You're getting these microphone brands, I believure Sennheiser, and I think Shure right now has a trade-in program, and they come and go. And I know that they want to try to, convince people to switch as early as possible so they're not having as many problems. So there are some financial incentives out there to do so. Now, and not only that, professional incentives, because now you'll have, being able to operate in a decent frequency. So 600 megahertz, if you haven't switched, you really need to seriously consider your options, and the sooner the better, because as soon as that area gets lit up, you could be in for a very bad time and then rush in to make a choice of what microphones to go to when that does happen. All right, now let's talk about what's available actually in the 500 megahertz spectrum. And let's talk specifically on a discussion that both Ben Stowe and I had with this one Facebook user. We were on one of the forums. Unfortunately, I can't remember who this person was or how this discussion came about. I think it was just, what microphones should we use? And it came to this argument that you should only worry about, in this case, like Sennheiser, A band. It's the largest band. No matter what, you're going to find something in here. And let's kind of get this part of the argument straight. So for instance, Sennheiser actually has three bands to choose from the 470 megahertz side all the way to 608 megahertz. And this is the width of the spectrum that we are, as entertainers can actually use. And Sennheiser breaks this up into three bands. You got the A1 band, you got the A band, and you got the G band. Now, in many areas, like I think LA might be one of those, the A band is actually one of the most occupied frequencies from television stations to repeaters to emergency responses. All these occupants can be on these frequencies. So you go to somebody like Ben Stowe, and he will actually search for what part of the spectrum that you should operate on. He'll see what's out there, and he'll say, well, G band might be best for you in this case. Or let's say you're using an in-ear monitor and microphones, most likely you'll suggest two different bands, so you're not having to worry about competing against different parts of the spectrum, and it gives you even more separation between an IEM and the microphones. Just don't go by the idea of, A is the largest, A1 happens to be the smallest, so A1 must just suck. Maybe G. No, don't approach it like that. Come through an informed, decision to, have the widest possible options. And again, you might be in a highly occupied area and you're on the most crowded part of the spectrum. And let's say it's A in your case, and you can find, something open, kudos to you. But it's kind of like a highway. Would you rather jump on a highway that has, it's already crowded and might, bottleneck up, down, just going up the road a little bit? Or would you rather go a less traveled, part of the road? I think most people would say the less traveled part of the road. So just, again, keep that in mind that when you do choose, again, Audio-Technica, sure, even the lower end with GTD and all that, go ahead and make sure that the frequency that you have chosen is going to be the one that gives you the most opportunity for a clear signal. And now a discussion on 2.4. And there's a few brands, even high-end brands like Sennheiser have, and Audio-Technica and some others, have options in the 2.4 gigahertz spectrum. Now, again, some DJs will absolutely swear by these. They've done them for many events, had absolutely no problems. But just, again, like my road analogy, the 2.4 gigahertz spectrum is absolutely crowded. You have wireless routers, you have microwaves, you have cell phones, you have a litany of options. Garage door opener. I mean, there's so many different things that operate on the 2.4 gigahertz spectrum, Bluetooth as well. Do you want to compete against all these other pieces that could be on this part of the spectrum? Now, most people would say no. Some people are just like, whatever. If it works, it works. I personally could never recommend to anybody, and I'm not a dealer or anything like that, so this is just coming just from me as a technical person, to use something that's in a crowded part of the spectrum. It just makes no sense. You are introducing additional risk when you really don't have to, and the cost savings from going to the 2.4 gigahertz spectrum really are not that high. So it's like, why not just invest a few extra dollars and at least make sure that you're in the 500 megahertz spectrum and not have to worry about competing with things against a 2.4. So for my own personal recommendations, I still have the Sennheiser G3 series. I've always been impressed with Sennheiser, even way, way back when. They just are a very high quality, product company to begin with. I've known touring groups that have used, the G3s that I've had. I just think it introduces this great balance of quality, of workmanship, of durability that, it's just been very reliable for me. Now, this is not to say that other offerings like the Audio-Technica and the new 3000 series, sure, has a couple things all the way up to the ULXD, the $10,000+ solution if you need four mics and want something in a 1U chassis. Absolutely awesome equipment. They're all good. I don't think that anybody makes a wrong choice by selecting any of these. Well, there's the video, and I hope you liked it. And if so, hit that thumbs up, click subscribe. There's even notification bells now you have to worry about. Do whatever social media is telling you to do right now. And if you liked videos like this and want to see more, go ahead and check out the 4 DJs Only playlist.